So we are continuing with vitamin A, right? See here. So we were talking about vision. Other than that, the other functions what we see with vitamin A, it acts like a steroid hormone. It regulates the like protein synthesis. We have seen, no, mRNA, then protein synthesis. Okay. Then it is essential to maintain healthy epithelial tissue. Okay. Then this is like, that's the reason you see any creams what we apply in winter, they are all like ingredients vitamin A, because vitamin A helps in the multiplication of the cells and it maintains the skin in oily condition. So it is also right, retinyl phosphate synthesized from retinol is necessary for the synthesis of certain glycoproteins, which helps in the growth of our mucus secretions, formation of mucus secretions. It is involved in the synthesis of transferrin, that is the iron transport protein. This we have seen transferrin when we were doing iron metabolism. So it is also helping in the maintenance of our immune system. That means it helps in the formation of immunoglobulins. Immunoglobulins are also proteins only. So vitamin A is also important for cholesterol synthesis during its various steps. So coenzyme Q is involved, which is actually dependent on vitamin A beta. Then carotenoids, these are actually present in plants, isn't it? So this is very, very important. It is helping in the action of antioxidant. Antioxidants means they will, see, during our various metabolic activities, we have the formation of free radicals. Like free radicals like hydrogen peroxide, H2O2, O2 minus, so many free radicals are generated. So these free radicals are neutralized by antioxidants. So vitamin A, usually there will be a question for 2 marks also. What are the vitamins which help in antioxidation activity? What vitamins are antioxidants? One of the examples of antioxidants is vitamin A. Vitamin C, vitamin E also act as antioxidants, killing the free radicals and safeguarding our cells. Okay. So beta carotene is also found beneficial to prevent heart attacks. Okay, the rest all things we have studied. Now we will go to deficiency disorders. So the various deficiency disorders are, first of all, deficiency of vitamin A is responsible for night blindness, isn't it? Nyctalopia, one of the earliest symptoms of vitamin A deficiency. Person will not be able to see in the darkness. The other consequences of vitamin A deficiency are the eye becomes dry, rough, fine, scaly. That is xerophthalmia. Okay. And you will see black spots appear on the cornea and conjunctiva. That condition is Bytot's spots. And gradually the holes may be formed inside the cornea. That condition is called as keratomalacia, which will lead to total blindness. Okay, and blind, this vitamin A deficiency is most common in children in developing countries. That's the reason you had few SPM classes, no? When you were coming for regular classes, there you have studied, I think, in the prevention of blindness. We have so many like national and international programs. National programs taken by our government and international programs undertaken by World Health Organization, where so many steps are undertaken to prevent vitamin A deficiency. That's why vitamin A is important in first year, third year, fourth year. Every time vitamin A comes, very important. Okay. So all these national and international programs, they work to give all vitamin A supplements to growing children to avoid all these deficiency manifestations. Okay. There is one injection also which is generally given to the children who are more prone for vitamin A deficiency, which can last for 1 or 2 years, sometimes 5 years also. Because we know vitamin A, where is it stored? It is stored in the liver in the form of retinyl palmitate. Okay, beta?
Okay.
So that is all about vitamin A. Then we will go with the next question. I think ketone bodies. Synthesis, utilization, and ketoacidosis. Chavi, do you remember the names of ketone bodies, bete? Chavi? Ritika?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you name the ketone bodies, bete? Very good. Acetone, acetoacetate, beta hydroxy butyrate. Very, very good. Now tell me, how are the ketone bodies formed? What is making our body to that leads to the formation of ketone bodies? Ketone bodies are not good for health, right? Still, ketone bodies are generated under some inevitable circumstances which are existing in the body. Can you please? Yes, beta. Ritika, I can't hear you, beta. Maybe you are right.
Starvation, ma'am.
Starvation, very good. Starvation, okay. Any other condition which is leading to this?
Diabetes.
Yeah. Any other condition also? Very good. No, I am. Page number skipped from my mind. Any other condition, beta? Yeah, it is here. Fasting, starvation, and diabetes mellitus. These are the three popular conditions because of which you will see ketone bodies are generated. Okay. Yeah, this one. See here, beta. As Ritika told us, we have acetone, acetoacetate, and beta hydroxybutyrate. These are the three ketone bodies which are found in our blood. Okay, so you can see all the three: acetone, acetoacetate, beta hydroxybutyrate. These are the three ketone bodies. So basically, our cells are very happy if they get glucose as a source of energy. And to get glucose as a source of energy, our cells are dependent upon insulin hormone. So whatever we are eating, once the food is digested, the absorbed food that is in the form of glucose is transported to the target tissues through insulin. That means insulin binds with glucose and carries the glucose molecules to tissues. But unfortunately, in case of fasting, starvation, and diabetes mellitus, in all these three conditions, because food is not available, our glucose is not there in the blood circulation, what is happening? Our insulin is not sufficient. So cells are unable to receive glucose as a source of energy. So when glucose is not available, then our body will start utilizing some other things like fats. Now, fats will start getting breaking down. Okay. So, what happens now? When fat starts breaking down, then you will get the end product as ketone bodies. Okay. So, what are the various ketone bodies we have? Acetone, acetoacetic acid, and beta hydroxybutyric acid. So, you have to concentrate on all these steps better. Acetyl-CoA plus acetyl-CoA, we have acetoacetyl-CoA. Okay, learn this flowchart. Okay, this flowchart is for ketogenesis. Okay, just reverse cycle whatever we have, that is for ketolysis. Okay, ketolysis is now, see here, this is utilization of ketone bodies. So in the utilization of ketone bodies, what is happening? Same thing, like you should start with these ketone bodies. Beta hydroxybutyrate, it's now converted to acetoacetate, then acetoacetyl-CoA, then acetyl-CoA, acetyl-CoA. So all these pattern, okay, these are the steps. Like actually, if you just compare, this is reverse of the cycle what we study for ketone body synthesis. Okay, breakdown is different, like little reverse. So once you are done with ketogenesis and ketolysis, then we will talk about ketoacidosis. What is ketoacidosis? Diabetic ketoacidosis. You will see, like in the blood, all these ketone bodies are increasing. So the same ketone bodies will cross the blood-brain barrier and they will also enter into the brain, leading to diabetic coma or coma due to prolonged starvation and fasting. Very dangerous condition. That's the reason ketone bodies are, as soon as they are synthesized, most of the times they are excreted in the urine in the form of ketonuria is the condition when you see the excretion of ketone bodies in urine. Okay, like ketone can be exhaled also. You will see the fruity odor in the breath of the person who is suffering with diabetes. Okay, acetone is exhaled. Are these fatty acids like ketone bodies can be broken down to acetyl-CoA. It can enter into citric acid cycle getting converted to carbon dioxide. So that is all cycle of this ketone bodies. Very dangerous, beta. We should not let this ketone bodies increase in blood. Immediately we should give the treatment, give insulin and see that ketone bodies are mobilized and excreted so that patient will not go into complication. Okay, so that is about ketone bodies and its complications. Ketone body synthesis, utilization and ketoacidosis. Okay, lactose intolerance. What is happening in lactose intolerance, beta? Can anybody tell me the page number? Ritika, you and me, same book, I guess.
Yes, ma'am.
Lactate dehydrogenase deficiency, I guess. 169 page.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah, lactose intolerance, right? Yeah, see here, beta. Lactose intolerance is here. Defect in the enzyme lactase. Okay, it is most common disaccharidase deficiency in humans. It is estimated that more than half of world's adult population is affected by lactose intolerance. That means some people, see, after growing into adult, they will not be able to take milk. Once they take milk, they will tell, no, milk is not digested. They are very much comfortable with curds, but not milk. That means what? See, as we grow old, this enzyme is deficient. Lactase is not there. Okay? So it is more commonly found in Africans and Asians comparatively with Europeans. Okay? Only this much, but it is as per 5 marks, but surprisingly 90% of adult Asian. That means in our Asia continent also, lactase deficiency is growing and it is now 90%. Okay. Then the treatment of lactose intolerance is simple. We should avoid lactose containing foods in our diet. So obviously milk and dairy products have to be avoided so that this enzyme, it's not there, so it will not cause any harm to the patient. So continued consumption of lactose by lactose intolerant individuals can cause typical symptoms of flatulence. Okay, so flatulence means like increased intestinal motility, cramps, irritation after ingestion of certain carbohydrates like lactose. Okay, beta. So this is again repeated. Lactase is deficient in case of lactose intolerance. Okay, that is all about lactose intolerance. And then isoenzymes. What are isoenzymes? Structurally, they will not be similar, but chemically, they will be catalyzing the same reaction. Those are called as isoenzymes. Can you name a few isoenzymes, beta? Examples? CPK1, CPK2, CPK3. Similarly, LDH1, LDH2, LDH3, 4 and 5. Okay. So structurally, they don't look similar, but they do same catalytic function. Let us see. You will remember more. This See, what are isoenzymes, beta? Now, see here, the definition, multiple forms, that means structurally they are different, multiple forms of enzyme catalyzing the same reaction, they are called as isoenzymes. Suppose if you look at this picture, just now we have talked about lactase, no? Like for the digestion of lactose and all. So here you have this enzyme lactate dehydrogenase, which is basically concerned with the conversion of lactic acid to pyruvic acid. We have this enzyme, okay, lactate dehydrogenase. Now this lactate dehydrogenase is existing in 5 different forms, okay. If it is something like 4 squares, it looks like this is H4. One box is represented by H and one circle is represented by M. So 3 boxes H3 and M, 2 boxes and 2 circles H2 M2. Like that you have different structural variations for these lactate dehydrogenase enzymes. So LDH1, it is chiefly found in heart and RBC, and when you just check with the electrophoretic mobility, electrophoresis technique, when you do, you will see the fastest moving enzyme is LDH1, like this one better. This is LDH1, fastest moving. This is the filter paper over which generally we allow these enzymes to get deposited by doing the electrophoresis technique. So like that, so if you just expose to heat, it is generally not destroyed at 60 degrees centigrade. And in our serum, 25% of lactate dehydrogenase is contributed by LDH1. Similarly, you can just read for LDH2, 3, 4 and 5. Okay, so now this is all for lactate dehydrogenase only. So in normal serum, like this picture you can see here, so the normal level of LDH 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, which is shown in this pink lines. So serum from a patient of myocardial infarction. See, in case myocardial infarction is nothing but heart attack. So LDH 1 is raised, LDH 2 is raised, but 3, 4, 5 are normal. Okay, this C graph is representing liver disease. So in liver disease, which enzyme, which isoenzyme of lactate dehydrogenase is elevated? LDH5. Okay, that is. Similarly, we have one more example of isoenzymes, that is creatine phosphokinase. We have creatine phosphokinase 1, 2 and 3. Okay, one, it has BB, that means it is present in the brain. This is present in the muscle and brain, heart. MM is skeletal muscle. Okay, again, you should check under which diseases these enzymes are increased. Okay, creatine phosphokinase. Okay, CPK1. See, there is a myocardial infarction. What are the, generally a question comes like, what are the diagnostic markers used for the elevation of acute myocardial infarction? That means in case of heart attack, what are the enzymes which are increased in blood? You can see, CPK will be raised, creatine phosphokinase, SGOT, serum glutamate, oxaloacetate transaminase, LDH, lactate dehydrogenase. All these three enzyme levels are elevated. How much they are elevated and by what time, how many hours of myocardial infarction they are elevated, it's given in this table. So myoglobin peak elevation is 4 to 6 hours. Time of return to normal is 20 to 25 hours. Diagnostic importance, it is the earliest marker. However, not cardiac specific. This table is very, very important, beta. You should write, this table in your answer sheet for your exams. Okay? Differently also this question may be asked. So these are all like, this comes as a part of isoenzymes only. Okay, I hope you understood. Then after isoenzymes, what is the importance of HMP shunt? Can anybody tell me? Shavi Ritika? I told many times, in fact. Hexose monophosphate shunt. I'm asking because if I ask more, you will remember more. Even if you don't answer also, you will start thinking like what may be the answer. HMP, hexose monophosphate shunt. Pentose phosphate pathway also it is called as. See, HMP. hexose monophosphate shunt pentose phosphate pathway. The name itself is indicating. HMP shunt is so important because it helps in the formation of all 5 carbon compounds, pentoses, NADP, NADPH, FAD, FADH, because these pentoses are very, very important during the mechanism of oxidation and reduction reactions, which we usually see in almost all metabolic reactions, carbohydrate, fat, protein, mineral, all metabolisms, nucleotide metabolisms. We see always oxidation reduction taking place and pentoses are participating in that. So he is asking us now, not the cycle because it's a 5 marks question. He's asking only synthesis importance. Why is it so important? He's asking. See, significance. It's unique in generating two important products, that is pentoses and NADPH, which are very important for biosynthetic reactions and other functions. Pentoses, so they are important for the formation of DNA and RNA. Isn't it? Deoxyribonucleic acid, RNA, ribonucleic acid, both are pentoses only. Okay, and many other nucleotides such as ATP, NAD, FAD, and coenzyme A. Importance of NADPH. This you can write as many reactions as you remember for your final exam. Okay, beta? So, like it is involved during the step of glutamate dehydrogenase for the biosynthesis of fatty acids, steroids. It helps in antioxidant reactions. Just now I told you when I was discussing vitamin A, what is antioxidation? NAD, NADPH, they help in detoxification of drugs, killing of microorganisms, phagocytosis. They maintain the integrity of the cell membrane of RBC so that RBC is not ruptured before 120 days. Okay, so all these are significance of HMP shunt. Okay, HMP shunt actually starts with glucose only. We know glucose can pretty well enter into glycolysis cycle. What is the reason? Why does it go into HMP shunt? Because it has to synthesize pentoses, which are so important to control so many metabolic functions of our body, to regulate and all. Then jaundice. What are the various types of jaundice we have, beta? This also we discussed.
Prehepatic, hepatic, post-hepatic.
Very good. Prehepatic, hepatic, and post-hepatic. Okay. So prehepatic in the sense what, beta? Under organ function test, it's given, right?
53 page. I'm not sure.
Or lipid metabolism. Okay. We'll first see organ. As you said, it is prehepatic, hepatic, and post-hepatic jaundice. Okay. So prehepatic, what is the reason, beta, for prehepatic jaundice? Yeah. If there is excessive breakdown of RBC, you call it as prehepatic jaundice, no? And if there is any obstruction in the extrahepatic biliary apparatus, you call it as obstructive jaundice, also called as post-hepatic jaundice. If there is something wrong in the liver because of which the bilirubin, bilirubin pigments are rising in blood, then you call it as hepatic jaundice or intrahepatic jaundice. So hemolytic jaundice, this is one. So like serum bilirubin, unconjugated bilirubin levels are elevated. What do you mean by unconjugated bilirubin? See, bilirubin is the end product of RBC breakdown. So once the bilirubin is formed, basically it combines with UDP, okay, for the transport into the liver. It is actually converted to uridine diglycuronide, isn't it? That is UDP. But unfortunately, suppose if it is not able to enter into the liver and it is remaining high in the blood, then you see this is not in combination with UDP. It is free in the blood. You call it as unconjugated bilirubin. Suppose if it is in combination with UDP, you call it as conjugated bilirubin. Suppose if both unconjugated, conjugated are there, then you call it as like bithin, like both. Okay. Then Vandenberg's reaction. So what is Vandenberg's reaction? Suppose if you collect the serum from the patient and then if you just look like you just drop Vandenberg's reagent, and if quickly if you see the purple color coming, then it is direct positive, isn't it? So direct positive generally we see in case of obstructive jaundice. Direct positive is possible if the person is having the conjugated bilirubin, isn't it? So then indirect positive in the sense unconjugated bilirubin. Okay, so unconjugated bilirubin, where do we see? In hemolytic jaundice. Okay, use my number. Okay, but so then that is one. Then in the serum, what are the enzymes which are elevated? Alanine transaminase, aspartate transaminase, and this alkaline phosphatase. Okay, you just check the levels of enzymes which are increasing in three different types of jaundice. Okay, so that is all about jaundice. What are the inhibitors of respiratory chain? Does anybody remember what are the inhibitors? Ritika, can you name the inhibitors? Amital, Retinone, Pericidine, British Anti-Levicide. Okay, I will show you once. Biological Oxidation is the chapter. I need to go to that chapter. See here, beta. What are the inhibitors of biological oxidation? See here? See, these are the substrates which are involved in the biological oxidation. And you are finding certain inhibitors to stop the synthesis of ATP at each step. So at this step of FMN, in order to stop the synthesis of ATP, we have amitol, retinone, pericidin A. At step 2, to stop this ATP synthesis, we can use these drugs, Antimycin A and British Anti-Levicide. In order to stop the synthesis at step 3, we can make use of these drugs, cyanide, carbon monoxide, and sodium azide. Okay? So these are the inhibitors of electron transport chain. Okay? That is, respiratory chain is nothing but electron transport chain. What are the functions of essential fatty acids? Name essential fatty acids. Linoleic acid, linolenic acid, and arachidonic acid. Okay, these are the essential fatty acids. So essential fatty acids are required for the membrane structure and function. transport of cholesterol, formation of lipoproteins like HDL, LDL, VLDL, and chylomicrons, prevention of fatty liver. They are also needed for the synthesis of another important group of compounds, which are eicosanoids. Eicosanoids means prostaglandins, prostacyclines, thromboxanes, all these, they come under eicosanoids. So these are the important functions of essential fatty acids. Suppose if these are... Sorry, beta?
Page number, ma'am.
Page number 31.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. Deficiency of these essential fatty acids will lead to dryness of skin, that is phrenoderma or toad skin. Yeah? Presence of hernia eruptions on the posterior and lateral parts of the limbs, back and buttocks, loss of hair, okay, poor wound healing. These are due to the deficiency of essential fatty acids. Then polysaccharides. What are polysaccharides? Monosaccharide chain, which is containing more than 3 to 4 monosaccharides, is polysaccharides. So under polysaccharides, what are the examples? We have starch in case of plants and glycogen in case of animals. Okay. The difference between starch and glycogen is starch is animal, starch is plant carbohydrate, glycogen is animal carbohydrate. And the length of starch is comparatively smaller when you compare with the length of glycogen. Okay, and glycogen is stored in the liver. Okay, starch is the storage form of carbohydrate, what we see in plants. So that is all about polysaccharides. They are also called as glycans. Repeated units of monosaccharides held together by glycosidic bonds. Okay, homopolysaccharides, if they are made up of same type of monosaccharide, they are called as homo, like both glycogen and starch come under homopolysaccharides. Heteropolysaccharides, that means it's a combination of polysaccharides with proteins and also fats, like those are called as heteropolysaccharides. Heteropolysaccharides are also nothing but glycosaminoglycans, okay, also called as mucopolysaccharides. Okay, so that is more than enough for 3 marks question. Then methemoglobin. What is methemoglobin? Causes and clinical symptoms of kwashiorkor. What is kwashiorkor? I'll come at the end, beta, methemoglobin. Kwashiorkor and marasmus. What happens in kwashiorkor? Protein energy malnutrition disorder. Here the baby is fed only with carbohydrate. Proteins and fats are lacking in the diet, because of which there will be edema due to the lack of synthesis of plasma proteins. The body of the baby will be all like moon face, fluffy. It will be all like as though it is water laden. Okay, that edema thing is nothing but we see in case of kwashiorkor, because the diet is only containing carbohydrate and it is deficient in all other nutrients and minerals. Okay, what is Kori's cycle, beta? Kori's cycle, we generally see it is a regenerative type of cycle which is taking place inside the liver for the conversion of lactate back to pyruvic acid so that it can be utilized by the skeletal muscle. Okay, we'll see the cycle, Kori's cycle.
Yes, ma'am.
Carbohydrate metabolism, beta, we will see. Just open the page and please let me know the page number. I think I'm very much close to the answer. Yes, beta, Kori's cycle. See here. So whenever, suppose we are very much tired and we have been using our muscle continuously. So from glucose, from pyruvate, lactic acid is produced. So the lactic acid should be again converted back to glucose. We do not have the enzymes which are essential for the conversion of lactate to glucose. So the lactate is now transported to the blood. Through the blood, it is now entering into the liver. Now in the liver, we have all enzymes. Like lactate is converted to pyruvate by means of transamination. Pyruvate is converted to glucose-6-phosphate and glycogen, and glucose-6-phosphate is now converted to glucose. That means successfully the lactate is now converted to glucose. This glucose can be transported via blood back to the muscle for the purpose of generation of ATP for muscle contraction. Okay, this cycle is Cori's cycle. What was the last question I told you? I will be discussing at the end. Methemoglobin. Okay. Okay. What is methemoglobin? Two not two and 274. You open 274, beta. I will open 202.
Okay.
Oh, I am very close to 274. Let me check here. You go to 202, beta.
Okay.
Nothing much is given here. We should go to 202 only. See, hemoglobin combines with different ligands. The normal hemoglobin, we know it is oxyhemoglobin. Methemoglobin is like the iron should remain in ferrous form. We know this, no? For the transport form.
Mm-hmm.
So like hemoglobin can be oxidized to methemoglobin. That means ferric form of iron in the hemoglobin is called as methemoglobin. Obviously, it will not be free to deliver oxygen to the tissues. So in normal circumstances, however, molecular oxygen does not oxidize hemoglobin. It only loosely binds to form oxyhemoglobin. That means if methemoglobin is there, the oxygen delivering capacity of the hemoglobin will reduce. Okay, beta, that is the difficulty. Iron is not in ferrous state, but iron is in the state of ferric form. Okay, that's what is methemoglobin. So it is not at all feasible for the transport of oxygen to the tissues. So in case of, generally we see the formation of methemoglobin whenever there is some poisoning with free radicals like hydrogen peroxide and with certain drugs. Okay, so that is. So this is basically corrected by an enzyme present in our body called as methemoglobin reductase, which is present in our erythrocytes, which will convert back methemoglobin to normal hemoglobin. Here better we have. See, hemoglobin ferrous form, it's very good. But if it is in ferric form, methemoglobin. So methemoglobin reductase. It's our link is getting disconnected, better.